A grid can be used to model a compound event involving two independent actions. For example, tossing two coins. But now suppose I want to toss a coin three times in a row. You can't draw a grid for three coins. It would need to be a three-dimensional table, which is a bit difficult to draw on paper. Instead, what we do is draw a tree diagram. Now the key to getting the tree diagram right is to work across the page from left to right. Always work across the page for a tree diagram, from left to right. The first part of this compound event is the first coin toss. That could result in a head or a tail. There's the first coin toss. Now we're going to move across the page to the right and put in the second coin toss. If the first coin was a head, then the second coin could be a head or a tail. And if the first coin was a tail, then the second coin could still be either a head or a tail. And again, keep working across the page towards the right and put in the third coin. If the first was a head and the second was a head, the third could be a head or a tail. And after a head, then a tail, again the third toss could be a head or a tail. The same again here, after a tail then a head, and again here, after a tail then a tail. Notice how the tree works across the page from left to right. Now we can read off the possible outcomes in the sample space by working left to right across the tree. Do it systematically so that you know you've covered every possibility and haven't missed anything. I could get a head, then a head, then a head. Or I could get a head, then a head, then a tail. A head, then a tail, then a head. A head, then a tail, then a tail. We're halfway. Keep working systematically through the tree. A tail, then a head, then a head. A tail, then a head, then a tail. A tail, then a tail, then a head. And finally, a tail, then a tail, then a tail. And there's my sample space. 8 possible outcomes. So now I could ask questions like, what's the theoretical probability of getting at least 2 heads? And I just look for the outcomes in the sample space that have at least 2 heads. Here they are. That's 4 out of 8, or 50%. There's a 50% chance of tossing at least 2 heads if you toss a coin 3 times in a row. There's another kind of situation where tree diagrams are very useful, and that's where you need to model doing something without replacement. First, let me show you how to model a simple event with replacement. Suppose you have a bag with 5 counters in it, 3 red ones and 2 blue ones. You're going to draw out 2 counters in a row with replacement. That means you're going to pull out one counter and then put it back in, replace it, before you pull out the second one. Let's draw a tree diagram to model this. The first counter could be any of the 3 red ones, or either of the 2 blue ones. That's the first action. Now move right and work out the second. If the first counter was red, well, you've replaced it back into the bag, so the second one you call out could also be one of the 3 red ones or one of the 2 blue ones. And that's the same for any of the first 3 options. And if the first counter was blue, then again you've replaced it back into the bag, so the second one could be one of the 3 red ones or one of the 2 blue ones. And that's the same for both cases where the first counter was blue. So in this situation, with replacement, there are 5 times 5 or 25 possible outcomes in the sample space. You can work them out by systematically working through the tree, going across from left to right for each outcome. And we can now answer questions like, What's the probability of getting two counters of the same color? That's these 13 outcomes out of 25, which is just over 50%. But what happens if instead you don't put the first counter back in before you pull out the second? What happens if you don't replace the first counter before taking out the second? Now you're working without replacement. Look carefully at our tree diagram. If the first counter was the first red one, then that counter is no longer available for the second draw. There are now only four possible options for the second counter: two reds and two blues. Similarly, if the first counter was the second red one, then the second red one is no longer available for the next draw, because you haven't replaced it. And again for the third red counter. And the same thing happens for the blue counters. If the first draw is a blue counter, then the one you drew out is no longer available for the second draw. Now look at the sample space. Five of the outcomes are no longer there. There are now only 20 possible outcomes in the sample space. Of course, I could just as easily have drawn the tree this way in the first place. I didn't have to draw it with replacement first and then delete some parts of it. Just think carefully through the available options at each point. If the first counter is red, then there are only two red counters left for the second draw. And if the first counter is blue, then there are three red counters left, but only one blue counter left for the second draw. And now, working without replacement, what's the probability of getting two counters of the same colour? Now, there are eight possible options out of 20. That's a bit less than 50%.